This PPT has been prepared exclusively for the education purpose by referring many prescribed textbooks, sources from the internet, and I do not claim any originality in preparing this PPT. We will discuss about the types of organization. This is the second session in module 2. Primarily two types of organization. First one is the formal organization. The name itself very clearly suggests it is completely filled with formalities, well-defined rules, goals, practices that lay a foundation for the formation of this type of organization. So hierarchy of power, responsibility, everything is very clearly defined. Work is assigned based on the division of labor. Examples include businesses, corporations, religious institutions, judicial systems, schools, colleges, government, and many other organizations wherein a clear-cut authority, responsibility, power has been defined. This is how it looks, a very well, neatly arranged form of organization. The second form of organization is informal organization that arises when people combine together, sit together, chat together, normally outside the office hours or during breaks, lunch breaks. Here the interrelationship that is developed is totally in an informal way. Maybe because of their affinity with respect to a region, or a language, or it could be their mindset, there could be attitude. Because of these things, they come together and form informal groups. This point was very clearly highlighted during Hawthorne studies. And the relationship that occurs here, which is not a part of the organization structure, even such relationship may also creep in, which is not at all defined in the organization structure. Some of the types are, say, McMites, book clubs, alumni groups. They're all informal organizations. It's not properly defined. People just join together, make some association, and try to come up with some ideas, form some informal group. Student group is formed in that way. This is how it appears. There is no clear, clearly mentioned hierarchy. They just join together to get the things done. We will discuss about the departmentation. What is departmentation? It is the horizontal differentiation of tasks or activities into discrete segments is known as departmentation. Normally, an organization or a company or an industry will have different departments. How do we divide those departments into specific segments? On what basis those departments have been set up? So that point is discussed in departmentation. There is no best single form of departmentation that is applicable to all organization or to all situations. So departmentation varies from organization to organization, and the same organization in the early stage may have one form of departmentation and they may switch over to different form of departmentation at a later stage. There are several bases for departmentation. First one is the departmentation by functions. Grouping of activities according to the function of an enterprise, such as say production function, financial function, selling function, or even design function, purchasing. There we are dividing based upon the what function they perform. That is called as departmentation by functions. But many organizations, even without the above functions, can be divided based on the other functions as well. This provides for coordination among various aspects of the organization. This is how it appears. See here, very well defined functional departments like production, finance, personnel, marketing. Very clearly defined four functions, and under each of these things, whatever the other departments we have, like see, production planning and control, manufacturing, purchasing. Under finance we have capital budgeting, current assets, budgets. Under personnel, recruitment, placement, training, promotions. So everything has been divided according to the functions that they perform. So this is called as functional departmentation. So here the predominantly departmentation is based on the functions that each person or each segment performs. Advantages of this form of departmentation: simple form of grouping activities. We know what is that we are performing, and accordingly we are divided into that particular group. Provides for excellence in performance through occupational specialization, because those who are in purchasing department, they are specialized in purchasing. Those who are in finance department, they are specialized in financing. So obviously it provides for an excellence in performance because it is occupational specialization. Maintains power and prestige of major functions. Each one of them have their own power and prestige. That's why they enjoy that power and prestige. Leads to improved planning and control of key functions, because you have a proper specified function to be performed by each department. So there you have a proper plan persisting to particular department, which helps in performing key functions. Simplifies training to various functions, because it is specific now. You need not have to train everyone in each and every field. If you are in a marketing department, train them to that particular specific function. If you are in production, train them to production function. Certain drawbacks are also there, like it is difficult to relate one's own task to whole task, and there may not be commonality of objectives. The overall development of the manager is not possible because they are restricted to only one function. He cannot have the knowledge of each and every function. The third drawback is unsuitable for very large companies spread over the globe. Not really recommended for such companies which are spread over the globe. Interpretations of conflict with each manager describing themselves as superior to one another, and they have their own way of functioning, that may lead to some conflict between each manager. Narrows viewpoints of key personnel, because each one of them are general managers of their particular department. When that is the case, the viewpoints are narrowed, and it may lead to some chaos. Slow adaptation to the environmental change, because you do not realize what is happening in the outside environment, and we just stick on to whatever has been done in the previous years. Difficult to judge the worth of each department. Which is better, which is superior, that is very difficult to judge, because one department may perform better, and because of that particular department performing better, other department will also enjoy the success. Second, departmentation is by products. Here, grouping of activities are based on the products or the product lines, not on functions. Suitable for large organization wherein different product lines are there, each product line will have separate departmentation. This is evident when organization is diversified and each product need different raw materials, different technologies and marketing methods. So you cannot put every egg in the same basket. So eggs are different, basket should also be different. In that way, departmentation by products plays a very key role, and that is the meaning of departmentation by products. This is how it appears. Under managing director at top, we have so many departments like refrigeration, plastic division, lock division, soap division, store well division. They are nowhere related to one another. Each one of them are different products. And under each product, there could be marketing, there could be human resource, there could be a finance. So this may be there under each product line. So this is predominantly departmentation by product. And under each product, there could be departmentation by functions. This is how departmentation of product is done. Advantages: places attention to product lines. You can concentrate on your product line. You need not have to worry what is happening on the other product lines. Helps management to compare between the products and act accordingly. If one product is not performing properly, you can concentrate on that particular product. Promote excellence through specialization. This is very, very important. You can promote excellence through specialization because those who are specialized in soap industry, they are in under soap. Those who are specialized in refrigeration, they are in refrigeration. So this is the advantage of specialization. Relieves top management of operating task responsibility, because each product line will have a separate general manager and a top management. As a result, the topmost level is relieved of task responsibility. Places importance of profit at the functional level. So each product line is responsible for showing the profit now. Limitations: need people with greater ability of handling. So since different product lines are used, we need to have people specialized in those product lines. Results in duplication of staffs and facilities. Each one of them may have a marketing manager, a production manager, a purchase manager, a dispatch manager. So it is nothing but duplication of staff and facilities. Under utilization of facilities of one product line, while the other product line may be dearth of facilities. So if one is performing better and you may provide that particular product line with lots of resources, while the other product line may not be performing better and they may find shortage of facilities, that problem may creep in. Increased expenditure. This is an additional expenditure because of more workforce and more facilities. Third form of departmentation is by regions or territory. Most suitable for organizations which are dispersed over the globe or over a large area. Many government organizations prefer this type as they can provide similar and adaptive services to the regions. This is departmentation by territory. Under president, we have marketing, HR, production, finance, engineering. This is common according to functions. Under that, I have northeastern region, southwest region, central region, southeast region, and western region. Each of these regions will have these functions. That is the advantage of this. The best example I can quote you is railways, Indian Railways. We have so many regions like Southwest Railway, Southern Railway, Northwest Railway, Northeast Railway, Central Railway, Konkan Railway. They have their own recruitment facility, they have their own HR, marketing, production. They are responsible for producing their own profit. They are totally autonomous. So this is the functioning of departmentation by territory. Merits or advantages: places responsibility even at the lower level, emphasizes local markets and problems, because northeastern will have their own problems, southern people will have their own problem. Language problem can be overcome in this form of departmentation. Can take locational advantages like availability of raw materials. If good raw material is available in the north, set up a separate unit there in the north so that you can take the advantage of raw material. So these are some of the advantages. It affords top management training, can invest in a region with better profit. So you can selectively invest which region is producing better profit. You can invest more in that region. Demerits or limitations are gives rise to duplication of various activities. Obvious, it's quite obvious, because every region will have their own HR manager, marketing manager, financial manager. It is nothing but duplication. Increases problem for top management to exercise control. Who is better performing, who is not better performing? That is a very difficult thing. For example, in KSRTC, we have Northwest Corporation and Northeast Corporation and overall corporation. Three corporations are there, and top management is only one. And exercising control on these three corporations, it's very, very difficult. Unity of direction may be lost because the people under Northwest region, do they listen to the leader of the Northwest region or do they listen to the top management? That is the confusion. Fourth one is departmentation by time. This is the oldest method of departmentation. Departmentation is very, very simple. Like the best example or the best method is shifts in working. Even today it is very, very popular and people work under this. This is shown like this: morning shift, evening shift, night shift. If the production increases, all these three shifts are used. If production reduces, night shift is removed. Then if the production still reduces, evening shift is removed, only morning shift is run. Then or else for 1 week they may go with morning shift, for the second week they may go with evening shift. Like that, they keep on changing the types of shifts based on the mode of working and requirement, that is the customer's requirement. Advantages: services will be rendered beyond 8-hour shift. So same facility can be used for more amount of time. That is the main advantage of this. Continuing cycle processes can be used for this work that is done in the first shift can be continued to second and third shift. You need not have to halt. Better utilization of the equipment, because same equipment is used instead of 8 hours, 24 hours. Encourages employees get higher degrees. As a result, what will happen? Those who are going to colleges can come and work in night shifts, so their education is not halted. Limitations are accidents will be carried from one shift to another. Normally what happens, the person who has done some mistake or some damage to the tools or the machinery in the first shift, they may hide the information, and that information passes on to second shift person, and the first shift person blames the second shift person, and the second shift person blames the first shift person. So the entire exercise is carried on like that and no proper solution is obtained. Supervision may not be done properly at night shift. It's very horrible time. Those who have worked in night shifts, we have all seen it's very difficult to work in night shifts. People tend to pass the work to next shift. So if you are not finding it properly, or if you are finding it difficult to understand, you just try to pass time and pass it on to next shift. Difficult to measure the performance of a particular department. This is another disadvantage of this. In the sense, see what happens. If I am not performing well, the blame may be taken by some other department. Or if I perform well and if that department takes the advantage, why should I work? Let me also stand back. That could be the mindset of people. May lead to communication problems if the previous shift's worker has not conveyed the problem properly. That's what I just explained now. If the previous shift's workers has done some mistake, if it doesn't reveal the truth, then the conflict occurs between two shifts. Fifth type is departmentation by process. Departmentation done on the basis of some process or technologies involved. So process is the basis for departmentation in this case. This type of organization structure varies from organization to organization as the nature of industry changes. Cement industry could be different, sugar industry could be different, steel industry could be different. So that is why as the process changes, the structure may also change. For example, fruit industry, automobile industry, chemical industry, they have their own products and different processes. And that's why even the organization structure will also be different. Work will be done in one place due to specialized equipments. This is how it looks. So here I have the board of director at the top, and similarly general manager production, general manager finance, general manager personnel, based on the functions we divide here. Under each one I will have manager crushing, manager pulping for food industry, say purifying pulp and paper rolls, cutting. So many people are under general manager production as per their specialization. So higher specialization is involved in this type of departmentation. So process is the basis for division of organization structure in this type. Merits and demerits. Merits are optimum utilization of machines because there are specialized equipments, 100% utilization normally. Increases the efficiency of departments, whereas demerits are if the process is sequential, delay in one process affects the other. If the first process gets delayed, that delay is carried further and the entire process gets delayed. For example, if a train misses one, say, station, normally the entire journey gets delayed. It's very difficult to recover the time from one station to another station, and that train goes on delaying from reaching the next station, and delay is carried till the end of the journey. Similarly, if one process at the beginning gets halted, that problem is carried further till the end of the process. Not easy to measure the performance of each process because each process have so many steps, and it's very difficult to perform the performance of each process. Each step is important. That's why putting the blame on the entire process because of one step, it's not proper. The next type of organization is matrix organization. The advantages of different organization, they are combined together to prepare this type of organization. It's also called as grid type of organization, and it's a combination of functional and product patterns of departmentation. The functional departments are permanent while the project departments are created as and when they are required. So functional departments, whatever we have, they are permanent, like marketing, general manager, personnel, finance, purchasing, production, they are all permanent. Whereas projects keep on changing from time to time, and as and when the new projects come, then only these project departments are included. The members of the project team will be chosen from the functional department. As soon as the project is over, they go back to their original functional group. That is how it works. If you are a specialist in, say, soap industry, and you are working in a production department of some other product, and you may be chosen to this particular project, and as soon as this project is over, you will be reverted back or sent back to your original functional group. This is how it works. This is how it appears. One publisher is there, and say you have editorial manager, production manager, design manager, and you have a separate team for book A, book B, book C, it could be journal, or it could be some other textbook, or it could be another novel, or it could be another chain of books, or it could be notebooks, like that. But each one of them will have an editor, will have a production editor, will have a designer, and that is how this departmentation by matrix works. So here the advantages of both functional as well as product is enjoyed. Benefits: improves communication and coordination, oriented towards end results because it is specific for a particular project and end results are guaranteed. Responsibility increases for each member as they become part of the project team. Now you are a part of the project team and the entire project rests on you. So that kind of responsibility will make you feel proud of yourself and bring maximum out of you. Helps you to tap the potential present in you. This helps the employees self-develop. Drawbacks: people know that their work in the project is temporary. So why should I scratch my head over these things? So they may not show full interest in the project and the project may fail also. That is also quite possible. Conflict in organization authority exists. You are a subordinate in one department and when you are shifted to a project, you may become superior. And who was superior to you in some other department may become subordinate to you. That kind of conflict may happen when you are moved from one department to another department. Disunity of command may exist because now the person who was commanding you may not be commanding you. So that one disadvantage is also there. And you may have to work under two superiors and from whom you will take the command, that may also creep in.